skal vi fra Danmark høre kat med Reds Ph.D. forsker og videnskabelig rådgiver Vibeke Frøkjær Jensen omkring elektromagnetiske felters påvirkning på dyr og planter. Hvad fortæller forskning og observationer? The effects of electromagnetic fields on animals and plants. What do we know from research and observation? Værsgo til Vibeke Frøkjær Jensen.
I think it's very worrying about the exposure of humans and especially kids, and it has also kept me awake for many nights in the past. But recently I've become even more worried actually about the exposure of wildlife. Because it's very good if our children survive, but if they don't have a world to live in, it doesn't help very much. So I would like our children to have a beautiful world with wildlife and animals, other creatures than ourselves. So I have to ask. As we heard before, health effects from 5G, what does the science say? There are no studies about safety on 5G. There are almost no relevant studies on the specific technology. But there is actually one study that I found on the effects of the high frequency radiation on insects.
It's not about health effects on insects, it's just about how much of the radiation is absorbed by insects. And the high frequencies are going to be used for the near field antennas, and that's the antennas that are going to be placed every second pole on the street, every 100 meter. And as you can see here, does it work? Well, you can see where the arrow is, that's 24 gigahertz, and that's just around the same frequency as the near field antenna will be. And the red areas is indicating how much energy is absorbed. So we are moving from this 3G, which is down around 3 gigahertz, or below 3 gigahertz, up to 24 gigahertz. And the insects will absorb a lot of more energy. So from this, we cannot conclude that these frequencies will be more damaging, but we can conclude that they will absorb a lot more, so they're even in danger of being die from the heating directly. And if they have the same effects, type of effects as the other frequency, it will be much worse because they absorb so much more of the energy. It's likely to. So what are the biological mechanisms below the healing effects from existing technologies? What we know from a lot of studies, this is a citation from a review that reviewed more than 100 studies of oxidative stress. It shows that there's a formation of what is called reactive oxidative species, that is chemical substances that are oxidizing other molecules within the cell. And some of these are so reactive that they actually can break DNA. And this type of reaction occurs both in cell cultures, in plants, in insects, in mammals, and in human cells as well. So some studies show that there's an influx of calcium into the cell. That is also important, both but directly, because that's a mechanism that actually happens every time we use a muscle. There's influx of calcium, so it enables us to use our muscles, and that also tells us that it's likely to affect the heart. But that's only one consequence of the influx. Another is that it might be the mechanism causing the starting the oxidative stress. When this oxidative stress occurs in the cell, it can the oxidative species occurs in the cell, they can damage DNA, as I said, or they can trigger what is called apoptosis. That means the cell kills itself, or it causes oxidative stress, and that is a reaction from the cell to protect itself from these chemical substances. If the cell cannot protect and fight these chemicals, they attack the enzymes of the cells, and that means that any cell will be hampered in the function of the cell. And that is why we see so many different symptoms from the exposure of EMF. So the DNA damage and apoptosis. So what we hear about the frequencies, that the frequencies matters about in these reactions, but actually the whole radio frequency field, we see similar reactions in many studies. And what seems to be very important is the intensity, but it's not a linear effect. What is even more important than the intensity seems to be in the modulation. And that is actually, that is what we saw in the first talk about the smart meters. You see these very high spikes. So you don't just have the carrier wave, which is a smooth wave. You have these very abrupt spikes, which make it very biologically reactive. And so there's more than 100 studies of DNA damage, of whether it gives DNA damage, and almost half of them show DNA damage. But if you look at those studies that don't find DNA damage, the problem is actually that they're not using the technologies that we are. So they're not using the modulations that we use in the technical devices. They're just making an artificial exposure for the studies, and therefore they don't find the effect. I'll come back to why that is important. So if we look at studies on wildlife, if we talk about damage of cells, of course we're most worried about the egg cells and the semen, because that could have lethal effects. And there's a study, for example, on frogs showing that exposure from cell towers caused 90% of the embryos and tadpoles died. And before they died, they had a lot of abnormalities. And 12 of these kind of abnormalities were unique for this kind of exposure. It was not found at all in the control group and not out in the environment either. There's effects on birds showing oxidative damage and DNA damage in oocytes in experimental condition. And out in the field, it has been observed that around cell towers, there's a reduced number of offsprings. It's been observed with stork and with the sparrows. Mice also stress-induced inhibition of ovarian and uterine activity. So again, lower fertility. And as a field study showing a progressive reduction of litter size in mice near cell tower, leading to complete sterility in the first fifth mating. And you know, mice, normally they produce litter after litter after litter and almost till they die. But if they're near a cell tower, it stops within half a year. There's also studies on human semen. That's in vitro, because it's unethical to even though men go around with a cell phone here, it's unethical in an experiment to expose men and then measure their semen quality. But that has been done in rats, and they find the same results in rats. So there's been there's of course a lot of studies. There's more than 100 studies on wildlife, and then on top of that comes all the studies on cells and on experimental animals and so on. But there's been an EU review on some of the studies, and they have looked at more than 90 scientific papers. It's not an exhaustive review, it's not a complete review, but they just have tried to make an overview of what do we know. And it's on studies up to 2016. They conclude that some effects are well documented, and that's physiological effects in plants. So what happens on the cellular level in plants, and there are also oxidative stress is an important reaction, but also other physiological effects in plants. Then there's effects on insect oocytes and larval development in insects. That's also very well documented. And then effects on bird magnetic orientation. And I'm talking here about the radio frequency spectrum. So it's both the technologies we use for 2G, 3G, Wi-Fi, and so on, but it's also the lower part, the radio area, signal area, and that's what's been tested on bird magnetic orientation. And that is actually an established effect that has been found. And it, so it's, there's an established effect under the ignea limits on birds. So actually, based on this, if ignea was evaluating the effects not only on human, they would then be forced to look at or to reconsider the limits. So the mechanism is also investigated a lot, and it seems to be something called the cryptochromes. It's an organelle that is also in other species, also in humans and in insects have cryptochromes, but it's only been investigated here. This effect was actually cited, I think it was in videnskab.dk yesterday, and the scientist was saying that if people think that you can transfer this effect and expect the same from higher frequencies, they have misunderstood the mechanism. But actually, Schwarz and Al in 2016 found that weak broadband oscillating field, and that is electrosmog, and also with oscillating fields at a very low level, is more disruptive to the magnetic compass orientation capabilities than most, if not all, strong narrow frequency band. And that is the scientist in videnskab.dk. He was referring to these Lamor frequencies, that it's only specific frequencies that can cause this disruptive effect. But actually, this study, that he's also a co-author on, cannot explain the mechanism fully. So I can't understand how we can conclude that you can't suspect that higher frequencies also can have an effect if they don't fully understand the mechanism. What is very important here is that it shows what we also see regarding the other effects, namely that if you have a pure wave, it's not very effective, but if you have many frequencies, like in the 3G, it's more effective than 2G because you have a broad band. And then if it's oscillating and you have all these spikes, then it's more effective. So I think it's very interesting that there are these similarities, and of course this effect should also be tested for the other frequencies. So, I should also say that before that there were a lot of other effects have been documented, but only in few studies. So this review conclude that doesn't mean that the other effects are not real. It just means that you need more research to be sure. It just means that you need more research to be sure of these effects. So effects of plants, I won't say a lot about it. I'm not a plant expert. But as I said before, oxidation is typical, and here you see some poppe, træer hedder det på dansk. Det er jo poppe. Men de her, det er i Nordamerika, de her træer er meget udbredte, men de er faktisk ved at forsvinde, og hvis man går ind og ser på skaderne, så... I'm sorry, I switched Danish, I didn't notice. To the left, you see the leaves, how they look when they've been exposed. And to the right, you see how they should look in autumn. And it gives dead areas. It also affects the roots of the trees. And there's another study in Germany, a very thorough study on trees that has shown that the trees are injured to the side where the radiation is coming from. And I can only urge you to read that study, Wortmann's seal. Tell some if you want to know more about it. I have to go on. So what I think is most worrying is actually the effects on insects. And as these experimental studies, as I said, they are very well documented that there are oxidative damage and genotoxicity. on the ovaries and the oocytes, but also effects on the larvae, on honeybees and Drosophila. So this is potentially very serious, right? There's also reduced memory and learning, reduction in feed collection, disorientation. This is also something that affects different kinds of insects. And then there's stress behavior. For example, the bees, they give us a warning signal if they are exposed. And there's a lot of research here, but the oxidative damage and genotoxicity is the worst, or the most well documented. So this is a field study. What does it mean? I mean, in a lab, it's damaging to them. But what happens out in the field? Is there enough radiation to damage them out there? And this is Lazaro et al. From 2016. It's a study in Greece where they studied the how many insects were in different distances from antenna, and they measured how much radiation was in these different distances. And they found a significant and quantitative correlation with the number of flying insects depends. So it's the more radiation, the less insects. If you look at, there was this difference between insects, because insects that are nesting above the ground, they were decreasing with the increasing radiation, whereas insects that were nesting on the ground, so their eggs and larvae are protected, they were actually increasing because they could get get more food because the other insects are dying. So this supports that it's the effect of oocytes and larval development that is crucial. And this is of course very worrying, because if we look at Denmark, we have cell phone masts everywhere. To the right, you see the cell masts, and if you look at the left, you see these habitats, Natura 2000 habitats. So it's not only in the towns and in the agricultural areas, it's also dense close to the habitats, or even within the habitats they put up cell towers. So what is the state of the insect population? This is a problem. We would expect the insects to die. And well, yes, they do. Almost 80% of the insects has disappeared, and this is areas, fredede områder in Europe.
Protected areas
in Denmark, or in Germany, sorry. And it's a long study that has run over 25 years, and they show that 3/3 of the flying insects have disappeared. So this is very worrying. So now if we look at the study, it's not only the species, it's not 75% of the species, it's 75% of the biomass. So it's flies, it's mosquitoes, it's everything. And this has serious consequences for the birds, because the birds and other insect-eating species, but the birds, they depend on larvae from insects and insects for feeding their offspring. So this is very serious. If we look at this figure to the right, what they have observed every year in different parks, and then they put it all together, and you see this linear decline, and it looks like, oh, it's a continuous trend, it's been the same for a long time. But actually, if you look at the scale in the top figure, it's logarithmic. So this means that it's an exponential decrease. And this means that almost all of the decrease has been within the last 10 years. And it's funny, because if you look further on this, it doesn't work, does it? Oh, I would like to point. Does anybody have something I can use to point? This one? Ah. Den her. Er det det?
Ja, du skal lige tænde for den venstre side.
Ja.
Så er det øverste knap.
This one.
That one. But it should be on.
It is on.
It is, yeah. Oh, there we go. Can you see it?
Oh, yeah, there. Can you see it? Well, if you look before 2005, it's almost horizontal. And then it, around 2004 to 2006, it goes down. So it's not a line, it's almost horizontal, and small decline because it has been declining over the years, and then suddenly it jumps down. So something happened back around 2005. And what happened? Well, we had a lot more cell towers. We had 3G, which is much more effective than 2G. So that's a possibility. If you look at the lower figure, you can also see that the orange and light blue are clustered together at the bottom, and the other ones are clustered above. So it's like, it's not continuous, it's like two ages. So it's in protected areas, and that's very important, because it's not because we put tile all over the ground, and then of course there's no insects. It's not because we increase the agriculture. It's not. It's not because the habitat. So the authors conclude it's not caused by climate change, because in their model, the climate change that have occurred actually have a positive effect on insect occurrence. It's not due to changes in landscapes, because in these areas there was actually more forest and less agriculture over the years. So the decline is independent on landscape. Actually, they expected that all the factors that they could show affected the occurrence, if they removed those, they would have expected that the insect, or if, because they included those, they expected the increased, there would be an increase in number of insects. So changes in landscape and climate change should have increased the insect. Instead, we saw an 80% decrease. They conclude it must be a large-scale factor, because it's all habitats, both in forest and in agriculture area and in grassland and in wet areas. And it's all seasons, as you can see in the figure below. So what is it? What has caused this? Also, they looked at trend in herb species. And actually, the trend in herb species richness gave a negative correlation. So it wasn't a change in herb species that was causing the change either. So they could not explain why. But I have a good idea. It's the lung change. Change, okay, I don't like this. Okay, so there's, what are the potential causes? Hello. If you had to look at a causal factor, seen as an epidemiologist, you would expect you have to. There's some criteria it has to fulfill. It has to be something that affects insects in protected areas and not just in the city, for example. It has to be something that can explain a potential decline, exponential decline. So it has to be something that has increased immensely within the last decade, and it has to be something that is large scale, meaning that it's all over, it's in all habitats. It's not just something that it affects agricultural areas, for example. And it has to be proven lethal to insects or insect development. And that we have probably radio frequency technologies. Particular cell towers are likely candidate because they are out there in the protected areas. And if there are other candidates, of course we should examine them. All should be investigated, all likely candidates, all that can explain this pattern of disappearance should be investigated. But right now, the responsible people, they're just talking about all the old candidates, all the stuff that we know has been eradicating insects for decades. But something new is going on here, and we have to find out what. And until we know what, we have to stop the building of more technologies. So because of this, the rollout of 5G is actually in conflict with legislation, and this is the Aarhus Convention, is that we should have discuss this in public, and the precautionary principle should be implemented because these habitats and conventions say that we should do that. And actually also the Court of Justice of the European Union say that the precautionary principle must be applied in this area. And authorities must ensure that there's no damage from any project on the habitat or species before it's approved. So here again, the government has failed. It also include cumulative effects, so it's not just effect here now, and it has to be assessed prior. And the EA, the European Environmental Agency, has said this earlier on as well. So I'll stop here.
Thank you very much.